Chapter 21. The City Gates. During the day, they rode south on the forest roads that connected Solidor through a chain of hamlets and fishing villages to Karasans. The villages were abandoned. The woods were not. At night, the army set up pickets where sentries repelled attacks from roving bands of Vorgs. The creatures never breached the perimeter, but the suddenness of the forays, the howls of the dreadful creatures, kept Nathan from sleeping most nights. Inevitably, he would find Hale already awake. Even on peaceful nights, the prince did not seem to sleep. Instead, Hale stood off, separated, gazing to the south, where Karasans waited. For all they had been through together, Nathan still did not feel privileged enough to break into those pensive moments of the prince. Caitlin, a few times, brought Hale a blanket to drape over his shoulders or a cup of tea. Once, Violin returned from the edges of camp, fresh from a skirmish, to convey some news to him. But no words lightened his mood or changed the grave countenance he wore. "What troubles him?" Nathan asked Caitlin one night, as the sounds of fighting kept them both awake. "Loss," she said, holding her cloak close to her neck with her fist, Talia asleep next to her. The Morvant girl could sleep through any noise. "He has lost parents, friends, and Adamantus. Yana is all he has left, and now her life hangs in the balance." "He blames himself for his father's death, that I know."
"His mother's too."
Nathan rubbed his neck with both hands. "I knew him as an exile, away from his true identity. How the burdens of his station sit with him, I cannot guess.
His responsibility to those he loves weighs heavier on him than the role of prince. To Hale, the High Council rules Anthor, not he.
But he must notice the way the men look to him, the way their eyes grow hopeful when he rides past.
He's too modest, too used to being an outcast. He rides with elves to his left, captains to his right. He likely does not even realize the men are looking to him, and not his companions," Caitlin said, readjusting her legs beneath her, the moonlight flashing in her eyes as she regarded Hale's silhouette leaning against a tree. The cry of a Vorg echoed through the treetops above.
"Hale will need to realize how they see him before this is over," Nathan said, reflecting on his own time as a figurehead.
"And we all need rest," Caitlin countered, reaching under her cloak and producing a corked bottle. "Violin gave this to me. It's what Talia has been drinking to help her sleep."
"Here I thought she had ice water in her veins," Nathan said, taking the offered bottle.
"She does. If she wasn't sleeping, she would be with the fighting, no doubt. Take a sip. I'll sit up a while and rouse you if you are needed."
Nathan did so. The liquid was strong and tasted of crushed herbs and viscous oil. Before long, he was drowsy, and despite the cries and clashes of steel in the night, he fell into a deep sleep. But it was not dreamless. In it, he saw the same skyline of peaked roofs clustered on a narrow peninsula of land that he understood to be Karasans. Rising prominently above the houses was the harbor light, a tower crowned with a soot-blackened cupola, where fires were stoked through the night to guide ships home. In his dream, the fire burned on a great iron pedestal, like a red star fallen from the sky, its reflection tracing a long path of fire over the inky harbor, where he stood on the opposite shore, a watcher who was also watched, for he could feel the presence of his master, like a familiar ache, his presence prowling the edges of Nathan's own consciousness, waiting for him across the waters, behind walls.
"You dare."
Nathan woke, groggy. The sky was the color of milk, and the camp was stirring around him. He was pleased to see Hale sleeping across from him. Perhaps Caitlin had prevailed upon him to try the elven brew as well.
Talia stole up soundlessly beside him, offering Nathan a cup of tea, dried apples, and cheese.
"Eat. Long march today to the city," she said.
Nathan thanked her, roused Hale, and they ate together in silence. It wasn't long before they were marching again. The column passed through a few more empty villages before entering a wood that was unnaturally quiet. Hale's blue jays and Gale's crow were the only birds to make a sound, and Nathan did not see so much as a single squirrel scurrying through the denuded branches. Scouts reported finding spoor from vorgs and the carcasses of deer, raccoon, and fox torn into pieces and devoured by the ravenous monsters. But there were no sightings of the vorgs themselves. When the vanguard crested a hill and the expanse of Kerasan's harbor opened before them, Nathan knew why. They had come upon the city at last, and the creatures had fallen back to fortify their positions. The city was a new one to Nathan's eyes, and yet familiar, for it was indeed the city he had glimpsed in his visions the night before, and in previous visions of his master's mind. The houses were packed in tight, growing upwards, 3, 4, even 5 stories, making the best use of the narrow space afforded them on the strip of land that was Kerasan's. The city center rose up on a hill crowned by a citadel, with windows smashed and blackened by soot, the gates in rubble. It had clearly been the last redoubt of the Kerasanians before the city had fallen. Now its flagpoles were empty, its walls barren of the colors that once hung there in banners. Instead, bodies of warriors dangled, missing limbs and heads, a warning, no doubt, to the Vorg's enemies. The closest approach was the causeway that crossed the shallow end of the harbor, skirting an impassable strip of marsh that connected the city to the mainland. The causeway was also littered with scattered bones, more victims of the Vorgs, the piles growing in size closer to the city, where the bridge met the wooden doors, a portcullis dropped down before them. Val and the elves conversed for a time on a bluff overlooking the harbor before riding back to the main column, where Val led a group of men to the edge of the wood. Under the captain's supervision, they began to chop down trees for siege engines. Caelith organized the fighters and had them drop off their spare shields in a pile. It did not take Nathan long to surmise that they would build a shell of shields to protect the advance party. When Lazalorn passed close to him, Nathan asked, in hopes of learning more of their strategy, "So, we will prepare a battering ram for the gates?"
"Battering ram?" the elf replied with a snort. "No, we have you."
Nathan thought it was a joke, and not a very good one. Hale, coming up beside him, broke his long silence to say, "Don't worry. He is a strange one." By the next morning, the ocean fog was thick over the harbor, giving Kerasan's the illusion of being a city floating in the clouds. While the humans and elves were lining up in ranks along the bluffs, Val came to Nathan where he sat near a fire warming his hands. Most of the others, Hale, Gale, Talia, Caitlin, had already been called away and given places in the attack or supporting the rear guard. Nathan had begun to wonder how he would contribute, if at all. Did they not trust him? Now that they had likely found his master in the flesh, could he trust himself? He knew his loyalty was with his new friends, but how would he react to seeing his master? Would he even recognize him? What wrath would the Magus have for Nathan, for turning against him?
"You dare."
"You look deep in thought," Val said,
coming up beside the fire. He did not sit.
"Just wondering what role I might play." "A crucial one," Val said, "and it is time to play it. Are you ready?" "Of course. Come with me."
Nathan followed Val through the camp, passing cooking fires that still smoldered. How many had eaten their last meal gathered there that morning? Nathan had not been able to eat, his stomach twisted in knots, his head spinning with nerves. Val wore a breastplate of armor given to him by the elves. He had forsaken his staff for swords, short and long, which he wore on his hips and back. There would be no quarter this day. Caitlin and Talia were with the rear guard, which Nathan and Val passed first. Caitlin offered Nathan a solemn wave. Talia nodded, her face freshly painted white and black in the custom of her people. Val continued, taking Nathan beyond the men, and elves filed side by side to the very front of the ranks. Here, at the leading edge of the attack, were the seasoned fighters, Chloe, Cody, Gale, and Darid. Even Hale and Violin waited, their faces grim and determined. Nathan wondered at the reason for his presence at the front like so. Was battle even the first choice, or was the plan to parley? Would that role be up to him, he wondered, as someone who knew the Magus? Waiting for them at the very front of the rank and file was the machine the men and elves had worked on through the night. It was a battle shell, shaped like a tortoise, constructed of overlapping shields and reinforced with the limbs of young trees. Val ducked beneath its edge. As he followed him under, Nathan's eyes adjusted to the darkness, and he saw hulking men lined up on the insides, like rowers on a boat. They would carry the shell to the castle gate, but where Nathan expected to see a battering ram and a party of men to thrust it, he saw only Gunther and Lazalorn standing in the middle space, waiting for him.
"Good morning," Gunther said. "Are you ready to serve?"
Nathan's throat was dry, and his mouth tasted of ashes. "In any way I can."
"Good,"
Val said, clapping his hand on Nathan's shoulder.
"Gods be with you."
Nathan swallowed with difficulty. "What is the plan, Gunther?"
"The same as it was yesterday," Lazalorn answered. "The gates to the city are wood. We will get close with the shell. Do you think you can burn through them?"
Nathan nodded.
"I know the spells, but the power..." "I will help with that," Gunther said. "We'll combine our efforts." "What about the portcullis? We can't burn through an iron gate." "It's held only by its weight, or so the Antons tell us. We should be able to lift it with a levitation spell, but we will need to conserve our strength for that effort."
"Which is why they need us to burn through the doors," Gunther said.
"I'll do my best." "Nothing less."
Lazalorn shot his tattooed arm out, and in a voice that was soft, as if simply starting off on an easy ride in the countryside, and not the siege of a fortified city full of monsters, he said,
"Let's move forward, then."
Elves and men alike hefted up the shell and started down the slope to the harbor. Nathan could not see far ahead of them. Instead, he marked their progress by the ground beneath their feet. Rough ground gave way to the hard-packed earth of the trade road, which in turn gave way to the paved stones of the causeway. They were no more than a few steps onto the bridge when arrows began to thump on the roof of the shell and clatter on the ground outside. Nathan knew the causeway was long, but it felt shorter that morning, the walls of the city looming up all too soon. Closer in, objects the size and shape of melons banged on the shields above and the stones below them. A few rolled beneath, the carriers stepping over and around them. Only when he nearly tripped over one did Nathan realize they were decapitated heads of Kerasan soldiers, mauled, bruised, and bitten. He felt lightheaded and nauseous. Lazalorn grabbed him under the arm with a firm hand.
"Steady."
Now full-sized spears were clanking down on the shields. Nathan trained his eyes up, but he kicked another head. The blank eyes of a woman, the rotting flesh peeling from her face, rolled up at him. The doors were close now, but two more heads dropped down in the space between them and the shell. Nathan retched and would have fallen to his knees if not for Lazalorn's grip. Gunther, too, helped him forward. Nathan's feet splashed with his own vomit now, but at that moment nobody cared. Hot oil splashed down on the roof and seeped down through the gaps between the shields. A man cried out as his flesh was scalded, but the shell pressed forward. Heavy rocks now clanged against the shields, followed by the crash of footfalls and the rush of feet. The horrible growls of the Vorgs were just on the other side of their shields. Gray Vorgs appeared at the front and rear of the shell, but the men and elves within were ready with a wall of spears. Emptying his stomach had made Nathan feel lighter, less sluggish, more focused. He drew his own sword, trying to remember what Hale had taught him about fighting larger opponents in combat, but what chance he would have against a Grey Vorg he did not know. He would have opted for magic, but a look at the heavy doors reminded him of the power he needed to save. Lazalorn and the other warriors prevailed on the Vorgs before them. Stepping over their bodies, they brought the shell flush against the doors. Nathan could smell the sour odor of rot, blood, and excrement that emanated from the monsters.
"Now is the time," the elf said.
Nathan pressed forward, Gunther at his back, his hands on his shoulders. Through the gaps in the front of the shell, they could see the doors. They were carved with scenes of ships in relief. Sailors climbed the rigging, longshoremen unloaded goods, and children played among their mother's skirts on the quay. The faces were rubbed expressionless by the elements and the touch of so many thousands of travelers. But still, the carvings harkened back to better times of peace and trade, not the nightmare of a battle they were in now. Nathan cleared his mind, recalled the incantations for enchanted fire, spoke spells of protection as not to incinerate his own flesh, and pressed his hands to the doors. He had not been trained to heal or create, but he could destroy. Flames radiated out from his palms, and the wood began to scale. He spoke a second incantation to protect the others from the force of the heat as the doors began to glow red and orange. The oil on the shell burst into flame with a whoosh, drips of fire seeping through the seams between the shields to burn like tiny tongues upon the ground. The Vorgs at the back of the shell stepped up their attack, slamming axes into the plating of shields. As soon as an axe broke through, Lazalorn snapped back his bowstring and let fly an arrow through the gap. Outside, a Vorg screamed as he struck his target.
"Concentrate," Gunther said.
Nathan could feel Gunther's weatherworker's power coursing through him, giving life to the flames and eating away at the doors. Daylight poured in from above as Vorgs pulled a shield free and smashed through the wooden braces. Gunther kept his hands on Nathan's shoulders, one of the elves sending a throwing axe into the gap where it lodged in the face of the next unlucky Vorg to look down. Still another crashed through, Lazalorn taking off his legs at the knees with a swing of his sword. The fire on the doors had taken on its own life, the carvings already reduced to ash. Nathan felt his power ebbing. He was drained, as if he had been fasting without food or water for days. Gunther sensed it and willed more of his own strength into him. Then, even that tapered, and they both stepped back.
"It will have to suffice," Gunther said.
Before their eyes, the doors began to wither and crumble, embers peeling away, ash swirling into the air. Over his shoulder, Nathan saw an elf fall to the ground, mortally wounded by the axe of a Vorg. A human stepped up to take his place, but Nathan knew there was little time left. He turned back to the doors, gathered his reserves of power, and sent forth a spell of dismantling. The doors, grown weak and brittle, exploded in a rain of sparks, the wood collapsing in a smoking heap, the empty hinges growing red hot. Through the clouds waited a wall of Vorgs, their mouths glistening with saliva, their eyes narrowed to slits of rage. The only thing that stood between was the iron portcullis, and Lazalorn intended to raise it. He did not hesitate. In unison with the other elves, they made a lifting motion with their hands. The portcullis shuddered and inched open, its teeth of iron points rising from the earth. The Vorgs threw themselves on it at first, to drag it down, but when it was clear their brawn was no match for the elven magic, they rolled under to charge the open end of the shell. But the humans rushed forward first, past Nathan and Gunther to fight them, slashing, stabbing, and hacking into their numbers. The confines of the archway made all the combat close, jumbled, and intimate. The portcullis raised higher than the shell, and the elves pushed it forward into the breach before releasing their spell and letting the teeth drop down. The shields lodged the gate open like a stick in a beast's jaw. The city was open. The forces of the Vorgs met with those of elf and human.
"What do we do now?" Nathan asked, falling back as the press of their fighters folded under the full onslaught of the Vorgs.
Gunther drew his sword and swung a shield down off his back.
"We hope that the others are on their way."